Hello everyone and welcome to a Deck Tech on the Constructor Criticism YouTube channel. I'm Spencer, host of Constructor Criticism and Limited Time Only, two podcasts about getting better at Magic the Gathering. Today we're going over Modern Deck, Titanshift. This is a deck that I've done Deck Techs on before. This is kind of an update with Hour of Devastation. There's a new card, as you can see on your screen. We have Hour of Promise. I played in a PPTQ yesterday, taking third place, losing a top 8 to a good friend of mine, former host of Limited Time Only, Travis Padilla. And this deck was really good for me. I actually updated it because of how good some of the cards were. And I kind of want to go over the deck and how I think it should be played going into this PPTQ season to start with. And some of the card choices that I'm making, why I'm making them. Because I think this list has gotten pretty interesting as I've worked on it. We have two Engineered Explosives. This is a card that I think you can play this or Chalice of the Void depending on what you expect your meta to be like. But I think it's really important to have some kind of answer and or proactive approach to beating things like Death Shadow. And Engineering Explosives is a big part of that. I was able to 2-for-1 at Death Shadow yesterday when playing the deck. They really don't expect Engineering Explosives, and you can really get them for it. I also got to Wrath Affinity with it a couple of times. I think the card just fits in really well into the deck's game plan. You have enough mana that, you know, 3 mana to do this is usually okay. 4 mana to do it's also usually okay because you can ramp and then just do it the following turn. Card's been really powerful for me and a great piece of interaction that I didn't realize I wanted in my deck until I started playing it. We have 4 Primeval Titan. This card is, it's called Titanshift for a reason, and Primeval Titan is a big part of that. You know, Titan being able to grab 2 Valakuts when it comes into play, and then if you untap with it, you usually win the game is very important. You know, having something that they have to answer, that, you know, they need something like Path or something like that to deal with is really good. And even when they Path this, you know, it's not that great for them, because typically you're grabbing some Valakuts, you can go get a mountain, kill something, deal them 3 damage, you know, whatever. And the damage is basically already done once time Primeval Titan hits the battlefield. We have 4 Sakura-Tribe Elder. This card is really good. Really, really good. People kept calling it Stee, which was interesting. I've never heard it called that. I just call it Sakura-Tribe Elder. But it's a huge part of the deck, being able to block while gaining you, you know, getting you a little bit of life when you sack it, by, you know, blocking something and keeping that damage from hitting you. It's really powerful. It comes into play. It comes in a lot. Comes up a lot, I'm sorry. And it's a huge part of the deck. It's probably the best 2-mana ramp spell in the deck. You know, and also being able to keep you out of Blood Moon range by grabbing basic lands is really powerful. Wood Elves is next. It's a 1-of in this deck. It comes into play, grabs a forest. I think that just having one more Sakura-Tribe Elder-like card in the deck was really important. This spot was typically taken by things like Courser of Kruphix and things like that, but I think the deck really just wants to be ramping and stabilizing, and Wood Elves helps you do that. We have 2 Lightning Bolt. This is a card that people tell me to cut all the time. I probably wouldn't have done as well as I did at that tournament. In fact, I know I wouldn't have done as well as I did at that tournament if it weren't for Lightning Bolt. I honestly wish that I could play a third one still. I think that there's too much Burn and Affinity with Goblin Guides and Swift Spears, and then even things like Affinity, that you just have to have Lightning Bolt in your deck if you want to be able to compete on some of these levels, and I think Lightning Bolt is really important. We have 2 Summoner's Pact. This card is Titans 5 and 6. Sometimes it's not that. I grabbed Wood Elves, Sakura-Tribe Elders yesterday. Being able to grab Wood Elves and then immediately pay for the pack the next turn has been really powerful, and it won me a game against Affinity that I was Blood Mooned, and it was really powerful. So Summoner's Pact is a huge part of the deck. I definitely recommend playing them. We have 2 Chandra, Torch of Defiance. This card has been way better than expected. As I'm retooling this list, I'll probably try and find a way to include more Chandras. I think the right number is 3. Right now I have 2 in the deck. I'm not sure how to make this card fit where I want it to be. 2 is fine. It's just so powerful. Being able to just play this after the board is cleared really takes over the game. I've emblemed this card. I've, you know, killed huge creatures with the card. It ramps you into Titan, it draws you extra cards. It's just really good. So Chandra's definitely something that you will want in your deck when you play this deck. We have 2 Anger of the Gods. This is one that everybody asks me about also. Between it and Sweltering Suns, they always ask why I'm not playing Sweltering Suns. And the reason is this. I actually think that that Dredge is good enough that you should just be playing Anger of the Gods. And the other reason, and kitchen things and things like that when you run into those on those small scenarios. But the other thing when it comes to Anger of the Gods versus Sweltering Suns is in the matchups where you want Sweltering Suns, or in the matchups where you don't want Anger of the Gods, and you want Smothering Suns instead, are you actually really happy paying 3 mana to draw a card and discard a card? Because I think the answer is no. I actually don't think that the cantripping is, at 3 mana, is good enough to make the switch, personally. Whereas Anger of the Gods' upside is so much bigger where it's important. So for that reason, the risk versus reward, I still prefer Anger of the Gods. We have 3 Farseek. This is another one that I wish that I could fit more of in my deck. I really wish that I could play 4 of these, 4 Tribe Elder, 1 Wood Elves, 3 Lightning Bolts. Like, I'm just short on... I have to trim a lot of stuff to get everything you want into the deck. And it's a little bit sad because I really think that the deck does want 4 of this card. But I just don't think that there's room at this time. So, kind of mentioned it before, we have 4 Hour of Promise in this deck. I played 2 at the PPTQ. And I was pretty sure that I was wrong after casting it the second or third time. I knew that I had made a mistake and that I wanted more of them in the deck. If it's 4 or 3, I'm not sure, but it's definitely more than 2. A common play pattern with this card is you grab a Valakut and a Mountain, either deal them the 3 damage that you need to deal them to make it so you can Scapeshift next turn and kill them, or grab 2 Valakuts and then your Primeval Titan comes down and basically wraths the board with 2 Mountains. So it's so good. Like, it does everything this deck wants. People are like, well, you're not playing Desert, so obviously it can't be that good, right? And it's like, you'd never play Deserts in this deck, first of all. And second of all, it does make an impact on the board so often when it comes down, because it either means that they have to kill you the next turn, or you get to interact with their board with mountains and things like that. And if you already have Valakuts in play, like, GG, the game over, this thing is going to often... either grab 2 mountains, kill a relevant creature, grab a Valakut mountain. Like, the options are endless, right? It grabs any land. It's so powerful for that. And going directly into this after something like a Wood Elves or a Search for Tomorrow is just really good. Going turn 1 Search, turn 2 Sakura-Tribe Elder, this is a turn 3 play that you can do on 5. The deck always wanted 5 drops, and this is finally a chance to have it. We have 4 Scapeshift. This card is also a namesake of the deck. People really don't understand how to play against this card with around this card. They're just not quite sure. So, to give you a hint, you need 7 lands in play to deal 18 damage with Scapeshift. You grab 6 mountains and a Valakut. If you go to 8, obviously... It's more than that. It's 36 damage. And then if it's 1 more land, you multiply that again. So there's tons of things. People also, look on how to play against this deck with Ghost Court and things like that. This card is not actually that confusing. It's just different than you think. It just often works different than you think it does. But it's not because it doesn't make sense. It's because you haven't played against it before. So definitely worry about... Also, I had somebody who thought that sacrificing lands was part of the cost yesterday. It is not. It is part of the resolution of the spell. So oftentimes they'll float mana when they cast the spell to have mana access mana through that turn. We have 4 Search for Tomorrow. This card is another one of the major ramp spells in the deck. Turn 1, you suspend it, and then it comes off of a suspend with a land untapped to put you to 4 mana on turn 3. So it's pretty powerful. Also, it also means that because the land comes into play tapped, it acts similarly to the 2 mana ones, where on 6 mana you can play it and Escape Shift to get to 7, to hit that 7th land. So that comes up a lot, and it's something that you should definitely know, is that none of the ramp spells in the deck, between Farseek, Search for Tomorrow, or Scribe Elder, or even Wood Elves, it also puts the land into play untapped. They all grab the land, put it into play untapped, or are cheap enough that on 6... you can go to 7 and immediately Scapeshift. So definitely something to be aware of. The lands we cut down to on 1. I'm not sure if this is correct. Right now we're on 26 lands. It's 3 Cinder Glade, 3 Forest, 6 Mountain, 2 Sheltered Thicket, 3 Stomping Ground, 3 Valakut the Molten Pinnacle, 2 Windswept Heath, and 4 Wooded Foothills. The reason we cut down on lands is I actually just don't think the deck needs 4 Valakuts, which is what most of them are playing. I think that you're playing an excess land for almost no reason, and that you can get a spell out of that slot instead and be really happy. So for that reason, I cut down the Valakut. I don't think it's needed. I think that if you have 3 Valakuts in play, you're just going to win the game anyway. It doesn't really matter. You don't ever need the 4th one. You probably don't ever need the 3rd one in reality, so... we have a sideboard of 1 Engineered Explosives, 2 Relic of Progenitus, 4 Obstinate Baloth, 2 Tireless Tracker, 2 Ancient Grudge, 1 Fracturing Gust, 1 Nature's Claim, and 2 Crumble to Dust. I've been really happy with this sideboard. I actually wouldn't change a card in it. I think that it has everything I need in so many different matchups. I found myself having cards for every matchup, which felt really good. I was really happy about that. Multiple cards filled with rules. Obstinate Baloth can come in against Jund. It can come in against Affinity. It can come in against Burn. You know, Tireless Tracker is great against Control. It's great against Jund. Ancient Grudge, great against multiple decks. You know, Affinity, different artifact strategies. Fracturing Gust, good against both Boggles and Affinity. Nature's Claim is one of your answers to Blood Moon. Being able to have at least one of those while also being able to come in against Affinity is great. The sideboard is just very versatile, and I was very happy with it. I don't think that I would change a card. That's kind of my update on Green Red Titanshift for the current PPTQs. This is what I'd be playing. If you have any questions, please leave a comment. I love answering questions. I love discussions. If you disagree with something, I want to discuss it. I want to learn. Something that I love about Magic is always being able to learn things from other people. I don't find disagreements to be disagreements. I find them opportunities to improve. So thank you everybody for watching. Please leave a comment, hit that like button, and hit that subscribe button. We really appreciate all of the support that we get. You can also go to constructorcriticism.com, check out our other podcast, Constructor Criticism, with limited time only, two podcasts about getting better at Magic Gathering. You can go to patreon.com/ccmtg to become a patron of this content. It means the world to us. Every dollar really does help help us make more amazing content. You know, getting people equipment for their new shows, for their current shows, things like that. It means the world to us. So thank you everybody, and have a wonderful day.